So hi everybody, welcome to TWR Facebook Live. So I have been traveling for last 15 hours, so and jet lag, and so I think talking about sleep yoga and dream yoga, I might fall asleep in the middle. So anyway, so this session is about sleep yoga, so daytime practices to prepare for the night. So daytime practices for preparing for the night. So basically, I think it's always important to remember for us that every time in our life, we notice something what is not working at that moment. We notice that, for example, people who go to sleep and every time they wake up and they would say, or for example, people would say something like, I don't remember my dream. And yes, that's true. They don't remember their dream. And they wake up, they remember they don't remember, that's all what they remember, and they don't remember to do a practice, they don't remember to pray, they don't remember to put intention, they don't remember to prepare to go to sleep, they don't remember anything, including not remembering when you don't remember. So basically, if you live with the cycle of not remembering, nothing happens. So it's really important to remember to practice. Then once you practice, then practice will do its job. So when as a fruit, as a result, it's not something that you make or something that you force or something that you put too much effort, but it's better to create right space, right enough time, right kind of energy, mood, prayers, preparations, and those things what really matters into the practice. So this is very much same thing. So maybe if those of you are looking, some of you are saying, well, my practice is working, not working, it's doing okay, lately is going really well, lately is not doing very well. This is just very, very normal. When I read the comments, I see all kind of experiences that people are having, and it seems like really, really very normal to go have all those experiences. And those people who you have more success, more result in the practices, in during the sleep, during the dream, because only that something that you have influenced your mind during the daytime, for example, even simply just because we are engaged, we all are committed to each other practicing. I've been practicing every night, and in fact, for me, last few nights has been wonderful, wonderful experiences, like I don't know, the dreams, some dreams that I would never have like these one donkey and one yak dancing, and not only dancing on the ground, they were dancing so, jumping so strong, so that they were from the earth to the tree shoots up in the sky, these yaks, like very wild yaks, and these donkeys. I mean, it's very, very funny. I have to laugh. Then I was so enjoyed and entertained and also surprised. Usually I could think about yak moving around, but not dancing, jumping on the tree and then in the sky. Yak dancing in the sky is just kind of, usually you don't think. So anyway, so it was just kind of nice, and then not only have that interesting dream, but then it was so funny that I wanted to make sure that I share with some of my friends and my teachers. So I was kind of working toward sharing with others in my dream. But, you know, sometimes it's like this, sometimes it doesn't work. So basically, bottom line, what I'm trying to say here is it's preparation for, how you say, preparing to go to a sleep yoga practice. So this is mainly what we're trying to discuss today here. So, and many of you have heard probably me when I'm teaching on a dream yoga, or when I've written in the book about, it's called four foundational practices of dream yoga, which is also four foundational practices for sleep yoga. So the first two are most important one. So let's talk about that. So first of all, when you get up in the morning, you just kind of open your eyes, open your senses, open your heart, go out in the world. What happens? Immediately you begin to perceive through your all five senses. You begin to see forms, colors. You begin to hear sound, voices. You begin to feel the energy around you. You begin to even smell, you know, like just sometimes very, very specific smells. Like you would notice that if you live in the city, then there's this kind of particular smell in that area. A friend of mine said, whenever she goes to India, she loves the smell in India. I don't know always I agree with that or not, but anyway, it's a kind of, even you go to India also, the very specific smell there, and suddenly some of them are very unique and something special. So it's kind of very reminding you something, triggering some kind of experiences in your mind. So you have smell, sight, touch, taste, all those sensory experiences. And all these sensory experiences are just coming toward you, happening toward you, but not necessarily they're saying anything. They are not necessarily, they are discussing with you, they are negotiating with you, they are asking something from you. No. So basically everything what you perceive not necessarily have too much impact, particularly not too much negative impact if you see them as they are. Maybe some kind of personal relationship to them, but other than that, be able to see as they are, like a neuroscience talking about the mountain. So if you look at the mountain, if you see the mountain as the mountain, you see the mountain height of the, whatever the height of the mountain is, as at this, at that same height, rather than seeing the mountain very high because you are very weak. And particularly when you carry a heavy bag on you, mountain immediately kind of elevates its height level. Or when you take out your heavy bag, mountain just shrinks down. So neuroscience, they say like perception changes. So the reason why perception are changing, obviously, it's not the perception is changing in a way. It's not like how you say the outer view is changing. It's more like an inner sense of self is changing. Perception of self is changing. When you feel changing who you are, due to that, what you're seeing is changing. That's very, very natural kind of science. So that when you're changing your sense of self, your view changes. That's kind of the key point. So in our awakened state, our sense of who we are always changing, fluctuating. What we are seeing, what we are smelling, what we are feeling, what we are touching, what we are tasting. Everything is beginning to change, ups and downs, and goods and bads, positive and negative, just because your state of how you feel yourself. So very often, when we experience these perceptions, it just happens to us. We don't particularly feel that we have influence. We don't particularly feel that we can meditate on our just sensory experiences. But the truth is, yes, we can. So everything, for example, right this very moment, for all of you, as you're seeing this Facebook Live, my Facebook Live, we have about 300 people watching it. Each of these 300 people are different. The way you experience it are different. What you're seeing, it's different. What you're hearing, it's different. What you're experiencing, it's different. It's different. So, and the moment I reminded you it's different, and maybe some of you are experiencing beautiful experiences. Maybe some of you are experiencing a little agitated, very doubtful. Some of you are maybe a little critical, skeptical. Whatever you're experiencing it, do you notice that? If you notice that, then do you feel that can you change it? Is it possible that can you change that? So that's the question. So for particularly those who are trapped into your negative perception of what you're seeing, you're perceiving something negative. If you are perceiving, hopefully you are, nobody is perceiving any negative this moment. And but if you are, then are you noticing that you're perceiving something negative? Are you noticing that this negative perception, negative labeling, negative dialogue, negative interaction has impact over your state of being, impact over your tonight, and particularly those who are going to sleep in next 15-20 minutes, do you notice that this might have an impact? That's, I think, it's very important. Now, second thing is, if you notice, can you see, can you change it? So how I can change it? Oh, I see that, I'm listening, I'm perceiving, I am judging. I am judging negatively. I am judging, the way I'm judging is because the way I experience myself, what I'm feeling this moment, who I am this moment, what I am feeling this moment is causing this judgment. And this judgment, this interaction is producing my sleep tonight. Just for a moment. Simply be aware of that. Breathe in deep. Breathe out deep. And just basically see if you manage to make any shift in this experience. That means, number one, noticing who you are, how you're feeling this moment, realizing this that is influencing what you're seeing, what you're hearing, your perceptions through senses. And recognizing your senses, sense perception, sense experiences, the way you are seeing it, the way you are interacting, where you are labeling them, where you are grasping them, where you're personalizing them would have influences over my sleep tonight. Therefore, may these experiences, if first of all, may they liberate by themselves like clouds in the sky. May I experience the clear sky. May I experience the clear light, the sunlight in the sky. May I experience the inner clear light in me this moment as I clear these thoughts and emotions. By remaining still, silent and spacious, open. Okay? So this first practice I think is really, really important. Imagine that throughout the day, people, how we get caught up with our pain body, pain speech, and pain mind. Somebody who is working a job, somebody is doing the job that does not likes it, but been working there for 10, 15, 20 years. Somebody who is being with a boss that does not like it also for many, many years. Somebody who is in the workplace where you really don't like it for many years. So all these many years of pain experiences that you're experiencing but not being conscious of it at all. But they still have influences over you. So if you look at last couple of nights, or let's say in 1 week, last 1 week, all the experiences that you have, quality of sleep, the length of sleep, the profundity of sleep, dream, if you look at all those things, clearly you can see, or if you remember, clearly you can see what happened, what did not happen, good, bad, but then you look how it's connected through the day. One single thought, one single emotions, one single judgment, one single perception, how you perceive things, how you see things, everything, what you see, it's very personal, right? What you see, you're looking, 10 people can look at the same thing, have 10 different experiences. It's a very much how personal identity influences on what you see. But when you recognize that, you feel you have a power to not get caught up. You have a power to guide your thoughts and emotion. You have choices in the junction, in the moments when you are suffering, when you are lost, when you feel you don't know what to do, or you feel like you're forced to suffer. And those moments, those junctions, you feel you have option, you have some choices. I have a choice. So the first exercise is very much linked with sense perceptions. Okay, so I think I've spoke enough about that. The second exercise is, it's a linked with the first one, but more specifically, it has something to do with interaction, interacting. For example, everything throughout the day, everything what happens to you, you don't always react to it. we are so conditioned. For example, if you're going to one office for 20 years, you don't have to even think about it. You automatically will drive there. You don't even know how you arrived there. You're just so used to, it's like a machine. If you are, way you analyze things, way you, how you judge through your pain identity, is so automatic, right? But judging, when you react to something and when you are perceiving something, is two different things. You ride the same bus for many years, but one day there's a big fight in the bus. That's a different. One day there's a person singing. Or you meet a beautiful person who has a beautiful energy. It moves you. It opens your heart. That's a different. You're reacting and you're opening heart towards some person, or you are fearful because of particular situation, or you get very angry at someone, but that's how you strong emotion and conceptual reaction to what you're perceiving. That is the exercise number two, part two. That experience is much more stronger impact, much more stronger storage. You're storing that information. Because it's much more personal, much more emotional, much more painful or joyful. So because of that, it has much more chance to influence your dream and sleep. Not only the dream and sleep, your state of being, your dream and your sleep. So that very moment, if you remember, I am getting angry. Just remembering that I'm getting angry, it's very, very helpful. I was yesterday in San Francisco airport, personal experience. I got early there, just give enough time to get to the airport and then have a little breakfast at the airport, and sitting there, and then some point, then I left. I left to my flight, to the gate. And as I arrived there, there was the boarding line, boarding group 1, 2, I'm sitting, standing there. And then suddenly I realized that I do not have my phone with me. And of course, right now I'm doing my Facebook Live through my iPhone. So this phone is kind of very important for me, and just whole my life is in there. So I was like a little bit kind of freaking out. And I'm right there at the gate. People start to, group one start to move. And I have a few options. I'm trying to think about where did I left. And I open my bag, look in my pocket, look it in my jacket. I could not find it. And so I said, maybe I might have dropped. So you can see, think about all the thoughts I might have dropped, I might have this and that and something. And I can, that moment I could see, like agitation, basically. And I noticed myself, because I have done this before also like this. I said, this time, calm down. A year ago, one similar thing happened. I was not happy about myself, how I reacted to it. I said, and you know, you were not happy about how you reacted to it. You reacted to it last time, same similar situation happened. This time, do it better job. If it's lost, it's lost. It's not a life, it's a form. Cool down, calm down. Feel your stillness, silence, spaciousness, and do whatever necessary to do it. The moment I said that, the moment I took my three precious pill, instantly, I felt much more calm and connected. And of course, I ran toward the place where I had my breakfast. It's the American Express Club, so that, you know, it's not like a too public place, but it's still a public place. So I ran there, 5 minutes, more than 5 minutes, probably almost 10 minutes. And a place where I was sitting next to a guy with a bunch of people there. And the guy was still there. My chair was empty and my table right on the table, I found my phone and just got it. So just example, this is my example. Half an hour before, I was in the same place. It was a beautiful place. I love that place. You know, you have the food free and everything is a very good place to rest. There's internet connection, everything goes. It's like a little beautiful place. Second moment I go there, my perception has changed. It was kind of a place where I lost my phone. And I was, clearly I didn't bring my practice, and that changed. So what I'm saying, first, when you're perceiving everything, when you're enjoying, enjoyment is the sense perceptions. Second, when you are kind of very reacting, kind of with agitation, that's second practice, is reaction. In the teaching, it's called, changing karmic traces. It says, paksha jur. Paksha jur. Paksha jur, that's the number one. Shempa do, that's the number two. Paksha jur means changing your karmic traces, because every second, every moment, you're producing a karma. Every moment you're producing a karma. Every karma that you produce influencing you and your dream and your sleep and your future. Right this moment, where you are, what you're thinking, what you're seeing, is you're producing your future. So the question is, are you producing a good future? Or are you producing a horrible future? Are you producing a good night? Are you producing a bad night? Are you producing a clear light? Or are you producing an ignorance? Every moment, that's what's happening. So these two are very, very important. I think the most important important exercise, I would say, that during the daytime exercises, which influences your night. Of course, that basically what you're seeing, everything what you're perceiving, everything how are you emotionally identifying, conceptualizing, labeling and so on. That's what we're talking about. Then of course you can talk about 100,000 thoughts about feeling good, not feeling good, and joyful, sad, fear, so hope, anxiety, sense of lost, countless kind of experiences. But the bottom line is, are you aware what you're seeing? Are you aware what you're reacting? Are you feeling choices and options? And are you able to change? Are you changing? Is it your regular patterns throughout the day? And do you see impact of that in your life, your health, your well-being, your night, your sleep, your dream? That's what it is. Okay, I think I said enough. So the last two, it's important. I think not as important the first two. So the third exercise is before you go to sleep. So before you go to sleep, every single night, before you go to sleep. There is one last thought. There is one last emotions. There is one light attention. Your mind is focusing on something. A last image, last feeling, last thought, last state of your mind, consciousness. That last thought, perception, attention, emotion, it's very, very important. Every single night you have that. And most of the single night, most people do not know what that is. That means, and most likely, it is not where you, not what you want. It's not the thought what you want. Imagine a person who is feeling too much happening in their life, too much confusion, too much pain, too much sense of loss, stress, tensions, and coming back home, and you throw yourself half dead on the bed. And then on the bed, then you're trying to see, you know, like you have these thoughts, a sense of loss, pain. And you slowly kind of fall asleep in it, or maybe even you don't sleep. Many people say they have a hard time to sleep. Of course, in Tibetan doctor, they always talk about the wind disorder. So basically means your conceptual mind is too active. Your energy is too active. There is no enough restfulness. There is not enough connectedness. There is not enough silence. There is not enough stillness. There is not enough like restful, joyful experience, like a child in the loving arms of mother. There is not enough of that. That's why you don't sleep. Or you might still go to sleep because you're too tired, but not necessarily you have a good thought or good feeling or good emotion or good place in your being, but you still fall asleep because you're too exhausted. So either way, you fall asleep because you're too exhausted, or you're not sleeping because you have all those things. This is what happens every single night to people. So they're very simple. The question, very simple question. Do you pay attention to your last thought? Do you pay attention to your last emotion? Do you pay attention to last sense of being? I am joy. I am love. I am clear light. I am still. I am silence. I am spacious. Or I am blocked. I am lost. I am confused. I am anger, I am sadness, or you fall asleep like that. This is the commitment, okay? In exercise number 3, the commitment is to detect and be aware of your last emotion, last thought, emotion, attention, even images. These are things that you wanted to remember. Okay? So as I'm saying, we are talking about this every moment is you what you're seeing, how you're seeing, what you're labeling. Are you with me? Are you aware that you are with me? Are you aware that you are listening to me? Are you aware of whatever you are feeling? Are you aware of your connectedness, disconnectedness? Are you aware you're with me? Are you aware that you are not with me? You see, immediately when you draw attention, when you're aware you're with me, it's a beautiful experience. The sense of being somewhere, being, the sense of connection to the being is a very beautiful experience. But also, same time, when you're aware that you are not there, it's also beautiful that it immediately brings you back in yourself, into this moment. So the same thing happens, I mean, if right now, as you're not going to go to sleep immediately, so that means right now, whatever is happening, you have an option to change. Oh, I'm not connected. I'm kind of listening, I'm really not listening. So I noticed that, now I'm listening clearly. You have option to change, you have changed it. But before, when you go to sleep, if you're not in you, with you, you're not in the right state of consciousness, it's very difficult for you to come back. It's far harder to reconnect in a dream than in the waking state. It's far harder to connect in the sleep than in a dream. Dream than in the waking state. In the waking state, there's a lot of, situation is a helping around you that helps you, kind of basically tells you who you are. Okay? So that's the number three. So I hope number three is clear. Number third is clear. Number four, let me go back to the number three again, one second, just very briefly. So number three is before you go to sleep. In Tibetan we say dumpa tang. Basically dumpa tang means sending an intention. So that it's not only a sending an intention, but that includes that last thought, last feeling, last emotion, and then being aware, and then sending, intentionally sending, saying, looking at your day, and then kind of having peace with your day, having, concluding your day, processing your day, saying goodbye to the past of your day experiences. Have more looking forward into the night and the sleep, and praying. So the praying is very, very important before you go to sleep. May I have a lucid dream. Remember, may I have a lucid dream. Remember, may I remember my dream. Okay, right now, just all of us together, collectively, let's say a few words of prayer. May we all remember preparation for the sleep yoga throughout the day, at least 5 times. May I remember every time what I see, perceiving things, what I'm perceiving. May I remember when I react to something very strong. May I remember before I go to sleep, able to process leftover thoughts, say goodbye, and look forward, entering into the sacred sleep, like entering into the sacred temple. May I have lucid dream. May I have sleep of clear light. May I sleep well. May we all sleep well. May you all sleep well. May you all have clear light sleep, lucid dream. May you all feel that you have a choice, you have an option, you have a power to choose, power to change. Dumpa Tang, sending intention with prayer. That's what we're trying to do. Okay? Now, last one. The last one is, okay, so after you did the number three and then you go to sleep. Once you go to sleep, that's it, right? There's not much you do. I mean, you know, then you, it's like an examination, you know, like a, you have to prepare before exam, not during exam. During exam, you have to relax, you have to rest, you have to connect, you have to be, not agitated, trying to remember, trying to put effort, trying to figure out. No. During, you rest, connect, relax. Before, you prepare. So that exactly, as you would do in your class, your exam, where you prepare your exam, exactly the same thing. In the sleep yoga practice, you prepare during the daytime. So then you go to sleep, just that's it. The next morning you wake up and you see, what happened? Oh, what happened? Did I sleep good? Did I dream? Did I have a lucid dream? Did I able to change anything? So if you have like a good experience, be joyful. If you have a not good experience, not any experience, then remember to pray, not only remember that you did not remember, not only remember that your practice didn't work, but remember to pray, remember to reinforce, remember to, strengthen yourself. Your motivation. Okay? So that's basically number four when you wake up. Then once again, then the cycle start number one back. So you wake up, then you, again, once you begin to perceive everything, you react to everything, so number one start again. So it's the cycle, these four exercises, it's like a cycle. After you go to sleep, then you wake up, then throughout the day, after you go to sleep, wake up throughout the day. So how many times you wanted to remember? So this is, again, I personally do that also. I think it's really important that I, during my teachings, I tell people informal practices, at least have some kind of commitment. How many times you wanted to commit? Remembering 15 times, remembering 10 times, remembering 5 times. I think minimum 5 times, remembering 5 times. You will never lack opportunity to remember the practices because there will be more than 5 times like you get confused, lost, angry, and strong emotions. And if you remember these 5 times, not only it will help your sleep yoga practice, it will protect you that moment to not create more confusion, more pain, more conflict. It will protect you. Like at the airport. You know? Just remembering it. Okay? So that's all. I think that's really like the preparation. So again, once again, how is your sleep yoga practice is going? How is your dream practice is going? And I have been reading all of the comments, and I see all kind of comments, right? So people having great experiences, people asking, like okay experiences, not able to sleep, sleeping first time in a long many days, and so on. So these all again, you look at your experiences, read other people's comments, and also it will help you also. Sometimes it's like everything what people share there, it's like a teaching, because everybody is kind of teaching to everybody else. Because I know the comments that I've seen so far, all these comments are from the heart. All these comments are personal experiences. There is no personal experiences which is not good. Every single personal experience is important. It's important. It's good. It should be valued, it should be respected, it should be acknowledged. One can learn from it. You can learn from your own personal experiences. I can learn from your personal experiences. We can all learn from each other's personal experiences, because a personal experience is never bad. It's always good. When you begin to talk from your conceptual mind, your intellectual mind, you're from ego, and even you can ask questions, fancy questions. Basically, sometimes people ask things instead of, I can feel it, I can smell it, that it's not coming from right place. And in the end, when it's not helpful. Basically, of course, we do that, and it's okay to do that, but it's important to remember to do that. So, but in this group was also, so far, everything what I read, I think all experiences are very beautiful, and I think we can learn a lot from each other. So I would recommend to people to read comments, others' comments, and share your comments. And regardless of, you know, like we just do this practice now, and then you're watching and you're having experience afterward, you share maybe even 4 or 5 days later, share is okay. So I would strongly recommend to share your experiences to others and learn from others' experiences to yourself. So you're, in a way, you're teaching and you're learning. You're teaching, you're learning. Personal experiences teaches more than your understanding of something, right? So anyway, so thank you. I think we, even though I'm supposed to be very sleepy, that I think I'm feeling quite okay. So I will definitely have a very good night's sleep tonight. So I'm going to do my practice. So just for a moment, we can all remain silent. And we can now, everybody have very familiar with the first two exercises, dissolving into the light. So just do the first two exercises. Bring your full attention inward. Be fully aware of the stillness in your body. Connect, rest, be. Be fully aware of the silence. Here feel, connect, rest. Be fully aware of the spaciousness of your mind, your heart. Be aware of your breathing as you breathe out. Send out luminous hung, luminous light. Your breath is light. You're breathing out. Every time that luminous breath of light touches any object of fear, pain, object of ego, object of long dark history, dissolving all these objects into light. Don't put too much effort trying to do that. Rather, allow to illuminate these appearances into light, because you are light. When you are experiencing that luminous within you, every appearances around you transforms into the light. When you see them, feel they are transforming or they are transcending into light, then it enriches your practice. As you breathe in, you're breathing in the light. And that light enters through your nostril in your body, transforming every organs, every cells, every part of your bodies, every channels, every blockages, every pain into the light. Again, allow to transform into the light by simply being open and being open, being allowing, rather than trying hard and getting disappointed because of it's not working. Allow. Right now, this moment, you're experiencing clear light, or you're experiencing much lighter body, lighter thoughts, lighter emotions. You're experiencing everything around you, it's light or lighter. you're experiencing collectively a clear, feeling more space and aware, feeling more luminous. This moment is shifted from before the practice and after practice. Before the practice, you're producing not too many good things toward the night. Now this moment, your experiences of yourself, your perception of yourself, perception of your seeing, hearing, feeling, all are helping toward your sleep tonight. Feel that. And I am helping all of you this moment. You all are helping me this moment by being connected to each other. Be aware of that, a collective power of practice only works when you're aware of it. Okay. So thank you everybody. So remember to share with others. So I know like many of you have been sharing the Facebook Live, and I truly wanted to thank you, and you are helping us to help more people. This is also, it's like a cycle of light, you know. Like I'm breathing, I'm impacting you all, you are impacting others, and I'm impacting them back. I'm feeling how that's how I'm inspired and energized, and even you know, from the jet lag, I'm wake up, you know. So thank you for sharing, and please remember to share with others, and also remember. You know, share your experience in the comments in the Facebook, and so we also just wanted to let you all know that we are planning right now. Soon we will have more information, a lot of more conversations with physics, with the scientists, with on physics. And the meditation, and also in July I have invited five Tibetan mempa, which just means a Tibetan doctor, medical healer, in the United States, who I just met at the Stanford University at the symposium. And they all are excited to participate Facebook Live with me on beginning of July. So we will also let everybody know soon who these people are, what they're doing, their work, and so on. So there are a lot of exciting things that are coming will come in our programs. So we will just. Remember, keep coming back on the Facebook here, and they will share a number of those things and schedules and dates with everybody. So thank you.